Today I want to talk principally about the so-called nu equals 5/2 quantum Hall effect, which is often believed to be a system which in principle can be used for easing topological quantum computing. I suspect I'll probably get through my actual slides before the time is up today. So if I do have extra time left over, I'll spend a little time talking about the Kitaev-Honeycomb model, which is another, at least theoretical, proposal for realizing easing topological quantum computing. Okay, so we'll talk then about the nu equals 5/2 quantum Hall state. Now, this is an even denominator state. What do we expect for even denominator fillings in the so-called composite fermion theory, which is, by now I'd say, probably the most accepted way of handling the fractional quantum Hall effect. Suppose that, indeed, nu, the filling factor, the ratio of number of electrons per number of flux quanta, suppose that that is indeed 1 over 2k, where k is an integer, perhaps 1, perhaps something other. Then, according to the standard composite fermion argument, the effective number of flux quanta which the system sees is the actual flux quanta plus or minus 2m times the number of electrons. That then is the number of actual number of flux quanta times 1 plus or minus m over k. Now, suppose we set m equal to k and take the minus sign here, then we get that the effective number of flux quanta is 0. That's a rather remarkable result. We would expect then that if the filling factor is exactly 1 over 2k with an integer k, the system would behave as if the composite fermions were in no magnetic field at all. And then close to that field, by continuity, the system would behave as if the composite fermions were sitting in a very small magnetic field. And in fact, if you look at the behaviour in the lowest Landau level, the experiments do seem to be consistent with that expectation. In particular, close to the nu equals a half, to half filling, the first lowest Landau level, then ballistic experiments seem to, some very beautiful ballistic experiments where you put the system in a, in a real magnetic field. You try to inject electrons, say, through a contact at this edge of the sample, and watch to see how they circulate in this field, and try to extract them at some other aperture here. And lo and behold, what you find is that whatever is actually carrying the current, the electrical current, does indeed gyrate in the field, but as if the field were indeed extremely small. So it looks then as if indeed the composite fermions, which are presumably the charge carriers here, are behaving as if they're in a very weak magnetic field. A very, very beautiful set of experiments which show that. And also, incidentally, I should add some very beautiful theory by Halperin and others, which tries to account for it. And it looks also as if the behaviour close to 1/4 and 3/4 filling is also consistent with that picture. Now, suppose that we now fill up the lowest Landau level with both spins. And we go on into the second Landau level. So that means nu is now between 2 and 3. Well, one's first expectation would be that the lowest Landau level is now completely filled with both spin populations. So it should be presumably inert. And therefore, at least at first sight, you would expect that the behaviour near nu equals 5 halves should be essentially the same as it would be near nu equals a half. Okay? And yet that's not what you see. What you actually see is that for nu close to 5 halves, you get standard fractional quantum Hall effect behaviour. That is, it's just as if you were near one of the standard Laughlin states, 1/3 or 1/5 or whatever. You find that, in particular, the Hall conductance in units of E squared over H is indeed 5 halves over the plateau to high accuracy, high enough, incidentally, that people have been able to exclude the possibility that what you're actually seeing is a Jane state with filling 32 over 13 or 33 over 13, which are, of course, close to 5 halves, but not equal to it. We can exclude that. Again, the longitudinal conductance appears to be 0 within the experimental accuracy. And that's actually, this has been known for a long time now. I think this was discovered already around 86. So it's really been around. So the question is, what is this state? Well, let's just first take a look at its principal experimental properties. It isn't actually quite unique. nu equals 7 halves, which is, of course, also in the second Landau level, now with the downspins being filled. That actually also gives a plateau in the Hall resistance and longitudinal... I've said resistance here. I could have even used the word conductance, since effectively they come to the same thing in the Hall effect conditions. So the Hall, the plateau in the Hall conductance, and a zero in the Hall in the longitudinal conductance. 19/8 is a slightly marginal case. It does give a deep dip, though not apparently a zero in the longitudinal conductance, and a barely visible plateau. But with these qualifications, the nu equals 5 halves state is essentially unique, apart from that. It looks fairly robust. The plateau and the zero extend over a range of something like 0.1 in nu. Got a large excitation gap. You can measure the excitation gap in the standard way by fitting the longitudinal resistance, or again conductance, to an exponential formula. Delta does appear to be a strong function of disorder. The highest measured value to date is something like 0.45k. If you try to take the existing data and extrapolate it to zero disorder, you find, that is, mobility infinity, you find that delta is about 0.6k. that, incidentally, is a rather small fraction of the Coulomb interaction. The Coulomb interaction is, in some sense, the natural unit in which to measure the quasi-particle gap, simply because if you were to neglect the Coulomb interaction entirely, then of course you would get no fractional quantum Hall effect. The gap would be zero. Now, magnetic field dependence is quite interesting. If you hold the perpendicular component of the magnetic field constant, and that means you're holding the filling factor constant, and you vary the parallel component of B, then it turns out that delta decreases linearly with the parallel component, and in fact extrapolates to zero at B of the order of a couple of tesla here. In the same geometry, it turns out, the 7 halves state shows a similar behaviour, which you might, I think, really rather expect, since it seems to be rather like the 5 halves state in most ways. However, for the Laughlin state, the quasi-particle gap actually increases with the parallel component of B. Now, the first, the most obvious interpretation of this effect is that your whatever your Hall state is, it has some kind of pairing in a spin singlet state. And then you would indeed find that a parallel component, remember a parallel component of B doesn't really affect, or is not, well, not usually thought to affect to zeroth order, the in-plane orbital effects. However, it would couple, standard Zeeman coupling to the spins. So the fact that as you hold the perpendicular component constant and increase the parallel one, you apparently drive the state away. First sight, the most natural interpretation is that it must be some kind of spin singlet paired state. We know, of course, from experience with ordinary superconductors, ordinary BCS superconductors, that a magnetic field can suppress superconductivity, not just by the standard orbital effects, but also by the Zeeman coupling. Now, theoretical conjectures. This is a horribly complicated business. I find the most readable account actually to be given in a paper which is in some sense somewhat tangential to the main topic, which is by Jason Ho in 1995, but you may find other things perhaps more accessible. Jane, incidentally, it's interesting that the most obvious place to look for a lot of these theoretical issues concerning the fractional quantum Hall effect generally is Jane's book on composite fermions. But if you look up Jane's book on composite fermions, you'll find he devotes just about two pages to the new equals five halves effect and really doesn't say very much about it at all. So I think he's somewhat uncomfortable with it in some sense. Okay, well, we're going to, for the moment, make the default assumption that the lowest Landau level is inert, so that effectively we can consider nu equals a half. Although we know, of course, we do know that in real life the nu equals half state behaves differently. But let's just focus on that for a moment. However, we will eventually have to put in expressions for the Coulomb interaction terms, which are appropriate to the second Landau level, and those are in general different from what they are for the first Landau level. And for the moment, let's not make any particular choice of spin axes. Probably the easiest description is, indeed, in terms of composite fermions. We can define a Hall operator, as in the original Laughlin theory. That is, you create a Hall at point A by multiplying by the total electron number, the product over the up to the total electron number of Zi minus A, multiplied by the original ground state wave function. The creation operator of a composite fermion, now you remember that a composite fermion is created, back a moment. You said a Hall operator here. Let's just think for a moment what that means. Remember that when we, in the standard fractional quantum Hall effect, when we put in a Hall, what we're essentially doing is to put in one extra flux quantum beyond what the system would like to have the exact filling fraction. You do it by multiplying, taking your ground state wave function and multiplying it by its product over all z's of zi minus a, which guarantees that no electron is to be found at point A. Now, how are we going to create a composite fermion? Well, you remember that in the composite fermion theory, a composite fermion is essentially an electron plus two flux quanta. So we have to create our electron at point Z, say, and then put in together with it two extra holes. So the composite fermion operator then is twice the Hall operator times the electron operator. Okay, so now let's think in terms of these composite fermion operators and define their Fourier transform in the standard way. So remember now that from now on until further notice, the quantity A dagger mu and similarly the phis etc., which occur here, are not single electron operators, they're composite fermion operators. Okay, so one possible ansatz for the ground state of your system is simply a product of pairs of up and down composite fermion operators raised to the nth power. That is, it's a Fermi C of composite fermions. And that is indeed, crudely speaking, that's the state which we believe to describe the nu equals a half quantum Hall effect. Okay, but we know when we're dealing with real fermions that they don't always behave that way. So another possible class of wave functions is a sort of BCS-like form, but BCS expressed in terms of the composite fermions. So we basically take the vacuum, and on it we create remember we have, I have to get my notation straight here. My total electron number here, I'm defining to be 2n for reasons you'll come to. So we want an n here, that's half the total number. And our possible ansatz for our ground state is that you take what is essentially a Cooper pair operator here, that is, it's an anti-symmetrized product of two particle terms here. You multiply it by this standard expression here, which you basically always have to put in whenever you're dealing with the quantum Hall effect, simply to get the asymptotic behavior right. And then you raise this to the nth power. So crudely speaking, then, in words, what you've done is to try to create a sort of Bose condensate of Cooper pairs of your composite fermions. You have various possibilities for this state. One possibility is to choose chi to correspond to spin singlet pairing. Now, there's just one point I should perhaps mention at this point. I've said this is your ground state here, but at first sight that seems odd, because remember that the way we tried to fill our Landau levels was that first we took the lowest Landau level and filled it completely with spins up, parallel to the field, and only then did we start putting in the spins down. However, one thing you've got to remember is that the actual splitting between the up and down states is only the Zeeman splitting. That's very, very small compared to the typical Coulomb interaction. And therefore, it's at least highly plausible that once you start taking the Coulomb interaction into account, you might, under certain circumstances, have to involve both up and down spin states. So that's one possibility. One possible choice here is to choose my chi mu nu here to correspond to spin singlet pairing. And that would one example of that would give you the so-called Haldane-Rosselli state. I won't go into that in detail, because the general belief, based as so many things are in the theory of the fractional quantum Hall effect, on numerical studies, the general opinion is that that one at least is not going to be energetically favoured. So let's think of a few more possibilities. You'd like, according to Lofton's original thoughts, you'd like to reduce your Coulomb interaction by keeping the particles apart. And obviously, one way of doing that is to make your wave function anti-symmetric in orbital space. And that means that it has to be correspond to spin one in spin space. So let's consider then spin triplet states. So the orbital wave function is anti-symmetric. Now you could, for example, choose your chi mu nu to be an expression of this type. This, I think there's been a typo here. This should have bars on it, it should be the modulus of z minus z prime here, where f goes to zero or z goes to infinity. That's to guarantee that you do have a confined pair. However, then in terms of the original electrons, your wave function comes out to be something like this. Remember, you have a zi, you have you would have, why do I say you have that for the moment? Have that because you want the original single electron. I'm slightly stuck on this one. I think I'd better rethink that and give you the justification for that perhaps next time, because right now it's not occurring to me exactly why I get that. Anyway, the standard argument as to why you don't want this is that the highest power of z, which would occur if you had this wave function, you've got this, and it's the product over 2n electrons, and that will give you a highest power corresponding to 6n. That will take us out of the lowest Landau level, where the highest power of z has to be 4n. Remember, you have your two spin states, so, and 2n particles in total. So the next simplest einsatz that we can try is this one here, where you've got a z minus z prime to the minus 1, which is a pure, effectively, a pure p plus ip state of composite fermions. Why so? Well, we're coming in the next lecture to a detailed study of the p plus ip state, and you find that at long distances, long meaning long compared to the actual Cooper pair radius, the wave function, the coordinate space wave function of your p plus ip superfluid is indeed of the form z minus z prime to minus 1. So let's try that, and let's try various possibilities for chi mu nu. And here, now there are two especially important cases. The first one is the one which has been certainly most discussed in the theoretical literature, at least, is the so-called Moore-Reed or Pfaffian state. Now, with a suitable choice of spin axes, you can now have both mu and nu corresponding to up only. In other words, you simply got up spins present, no down spins present at all. And if you write out this expression in first quantized form in terms of the actual electron coordinates, then you get this expression here times this Pfaffian expression. Does everyone know what a Pfaffian is? It's actually a rather simple idea. If you have 2n fermions, you can just form an expression, which is the you have an expression of the form phi 1, 2 equals some function of z1 minus z2. So you take the expression phi 1, 2, phi 3, 4, dot, 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 phi 2n minus 1, 2n, and you simply anti-symmetrize it. For example, you subtract off minus phi 1 3 phi 2 4 dot dot. Okay, that's all it means. So, the point is that this Pfaffian naturally respects the Fermi anti-symmetry in the correct way. So let's see, where were we? Go on. Yep, it's Fabian State. Okay, so this is the Ansatz, which Moore and Reed wrote down as a possible wave function for the new, of course, 5/2 state. And that's often said to be the exact analogue of the A1 phase of superfluid helium 3. That actually isn't quite true, in fact, because real helium 3 A1, it does have Cooper pairs formed in its upspin component, but it also has a downspin component which is not paired. Okay? So it's not quite the analogue of the Moore-Reed state. To get the exact analogue in helium 3, superfluid helium 3, you'd have to totally spin polarise your helium 3, which is, I mean, in theory possible, but no one's actually succeeded in doing it experimentally. Yeah. As I already remarked, the Pfaffian form here is exactly the wave function of P plus IP Fermi superfluid at large distances. Now, why would anyone believe that this is likely to be a suitable state? Well, it has a lot of attractive features. First of all, this factor here enables you, as it were, to get the counting right between the filling factor and the total number of states available in your Landau level, just as it would for an odd exponent here. On the other hand, by itself, of course, it would not be suitably antisymmetric. It would describe bosons rather than fermions. So the Pfaffian function corrects for that and gives you something which is appropriate to fermions. Second point is that the Moore-Reed ground state is the exact ground state of the following rather artificial-looking Hamiltonian. That's not obvious. That's, it's a ground state of this three particle Hamiltonian. You see, this is delta of Ri minus Rj times delta of Rj minus Rk. So this term only operates when three particles come together. Okay? And when three particles come together, then this function vanishes. So it gives you a zero expectation value for your potential. That, of course, does not prove that it's a ground state, and that takes more work, but it can be proved. Perhaps I should just stop for a moment and ask if there are any questions explicitly about the Moore-Reed state. We're going on to a zoo of other states. Yes. You see, it will actually vanish as the square because although you have one term in your Pfaffian, which has a 1 over zi minus zj in it, but all the others have 1 over zi minus zk. So in fact, it doesn't cancel that. Yeah. Sorry? Oh, sorry. Why it can't be particle hole symmetric? Because if you okay, another of these statements that are made frequently. Sorry. The Hamiltonian, okay, let's think about that. The Hamiltonian is certainly not particle hole symmetric as it stands. Question is, could it be, in some sense, made so? I have to admit, this is another of these statements which are often made in the literature without always explicit justification. And I'm sure they trace back to some place where this is justified, but it's not always immediately obvious. Let's see, can we see immediately why that would be? No, I'm sorry, again, I can't think that one totally through in my head. I'm going to have to. I mean, actually, that's only true if you stick close to the Fermi surface.
Yeah.
If you, but in fact, you see this this behaviour, this long distance behaviour, in the case of a real P+IP Fermi, it comes way away from it. So I think, I mean, in some sense, I think does indeed make it plausible that this is not a particle hole symmetric. Okay, we'll come back to that point when we deal with the P+IP Fermi superfluid next time. Okay, well, there's a whole zoo of other states, but there were, go ahead. Do you have a question? Okay. So the whole zoo of other states, of which probably the most important is the so-called 331 state. That's, again, a triplet state, not to be confused with the Haldane-Rosari singlet state. For that state, with the appropriate choice of axes, you find that chi mu nu is given by this expression here. So what that's saying is that the pairs of your composite fermions, now form in a state with total S equals 1 and SZ equals 0. So no spin polarization in any direction. Remember, that's a rather tricky point about two particles of spin a half paired into a spin triplet state. The obvious spin triplet states are up, up, and down, down, and they, of course, do have spin polarization. However, you have this symmetric combination, up, down, plus down, up, and that has the property that if you actually evaluate the spin polarization itself, rather than its square, that's zero in all directions. So in terms of the original electrons, that is given by an expression. Okay, this I think not a I not equal to J. Yes, it's an I equals J. Yeah, this is okay, but it takes a little sorting out. This expression here is telling you you've got a sigma I equals sigma J here. That's telling you have spins, you have both spins around. Particles of the same spin have a wave function which decreases as the cube of their separation as they get together. Particles of opposite spin, however, only have a power of 1, their separation here. That is, in fact, it turns out, this 331 state is the exact analogue of the A phase of the A phase, not the A1 phase, but the A phase of liquid superfluid liquid helium 3. Indeed, that has no net Cooper pair polarization. Now, there's one rather curious point which has had some discussion in the literature. If you look at the original electron coordinates, these two wave functions, obviously, this looks nothing like the Moore Reed wave function. And in fact, it looks as if it has a totally different topology. However, in terms of the composite fermions, it turns out that the only difference is in the chi mu nus. And Ho, in the paper which I mentioned, exploits that fact to show that psi 331 can be deformed continuously into a more Reed state without changing the total G, and therefore without changing the Coulomb energy. Which is a sort of paradox which people have tried to has worried people somewhat. Third state of the zoo is if you could, the antipathian, if you could neglect the Landau level mixing, then for a half-filled Landau level, particle-hole conjugation is an exact symmetry. However, the Mauride state does break that symmetry. It's the exact ground state of a Hamiltonian, which is not particle-hole symmetric. And therefore, there must exist an antipathian state, which is the particle-hole conjugate of the Mauride state. Now, for exact particle-hole symmetry, it would have to be degenerate with psi MR. However, in real life, you do have mixing between the Landau levels, and that could stabilize one or the other. Now, as far as I know, no one has actually formulated the antipathian wave function explicitly in terms of composite fermion coordinates, so can't immediately compare it with either of the others. However, people have... now, this is something I'm certainly not going to be able to talk about in any detail. It's quite a large subject in its own right. People have considered, in all these cases, in these possible candidates, they've considered the properties of the edge states and used these properties, usually using bosonization, to predict different values for example, shot noise, thermal edge state, thermal conduction, etc., etc. I say it's a huge subject in its own right. I don't intend to go into it. More of the zoo, even this doesn't exhaust the possibilities. Important, the sort of bottom line, however, is that different unsets, so that is different choices of wave function for the nu equals 5/2 state, give different, they give different values. That's perhaps a little misleading because all these states appear, for a reason we'll see in a moment, that they appear to give you an effective quasi-particle charge, which is 1/4, not 1/2, but 1/4 of the electron charge. So we'll come in a moment to an argument for that. They also give you a value for the so-called Coulomb exponent, which controls the properties associated with the edge state. For example, shot noise, tunneling characteristics, etc., etc. And what's interesting, you see, is that these different states, they all have the same value of E star, E of 4, but they have different values of the G parameter here. Moreover, it turns out, or at least it's a general belief, that both the Mauride state and the antipathian, which is its particle-hole conjugate, have non-abelian excitations, whereas the 331 and some of the others have abelian excitations. So that, of course, makes it rather urgent to try to sort out experimentally which of these is actually occurring. Now we come to this rather delicate point about the quasi-particle excitations of the Mauride state. At first sight, you'd say, since nu equals 1/2, we know that, for example, for nu equals 1/3, standard Laughlin state, we know that the effective charge is 1/3 of the electron charge. So similarly here, at first sight, you might expect that you'd have a elementary excitation charge, which is 1/2 E. However, that's probably a bit too simple. This argument, I think, is a sort of hand-waving, but perhaps somewhat persuasive one. Just imagine for the moment, you're trying to form, in some sense, Cooper pairs out of your composite fermions. So imagine that your pairs are tightly bound, and so you're forming structureless bosons, and presumably, from our experience, for example, with the BEC-BCS crossover in dilute alkali gases, ultra-cold alkali gases, you might expect that the effective interaction between the bosons would be repulsive. It certainly is in the ultra-cold gases. Then what we'd have is we'd have a number of bosons, which is 1/2 the number of electrons, but of course the charge on the bosons would be twice that on the electrons. So the effective filling factor of the bosons, which is number of bosons, or density of bosons, times H over the charge of the bosons, times B, that then is just a quarter of the actual original electron filling factor. Now that original factor was half, so this gives us an eighth. Now for bosons with filling 1/8, we can legitimately postulate this kind of standard Laplace wave function. You see, now we're dealing with bosons, so it doesn't matter that the exponent here is even. In fact, it ought to be even. Then, you might argue by the usual arguments, quasi-whole excitations would be created by the standard operator of this type, and then they'd have charge, E star, which is minus EB over 8, that is minus E over 4. And then you might wave your hands and argue that by continuity, that result should remain valid, even when the binding is not very strong, but of some kind of intermediate strength, as long as the pairs still exist. Notice, incidentally, that in this argument, a quasi-hole would, and this is a rather delicate point, a quasi-hole would correspond to insertion of a flux H over EB, which is H over 2E, as in real-life superconductors, not H over E. Another sort of rather hand-waving argument, a second one, from Wen and New, the general result of Wen and New, which remember, going back for a moment, we did this, we covered this argument of Wen and New in some detail in an earlier lecture, and one thing I want to remind you of is that, first of all, it was really not particularly specific to the quantum Hall effect. It's much more general than that. And secondly, it was nowhere said that the filling fraction was odd. The argument goes through equally well for an even filling factor. So from the Wen and New argument, if you have you put your system on a torus, then the degeneracy on the torus is at least a factor of 2. And therefore, by the kind of arguments I went through earlier for the Laughlin states, the minimum period in a minimum effective period in a Corbino disk geometry is 2 phi 0. But a quasi-hole corresponds to the insertion of H over 2, that's half a flux quantum, and therefore you need 4 quasi-particles to make one period. So that would then again say that, or indicate, that the charge is indeed minus E over 4. Now, there's a slightly tricky point about how you actually construct your wave function. The bosonic coordinate is the center of mass of two fermions, and so you want your quasi-hole wave function to be a product of this type. And I'm sorry, I think, again, there is a typo here. This should be a 2n, almost certainly, here, because remember that 2n was my total number of electrons. Okay, you might say this is very hand-waving and not terribly rigorous, and you'd be right. But this is the level at which most of the discussion in the literature is done. Okay, we get on to something even more tricky, which is the quasi-particle statistics in this in these states. This is was first, I think, discussed in any detail by Nyack and Wilczek in this paper in nuclear physics, or one of the classic papers in this area. They proposed to make two quasi-hole states by taking now a Pfaffian of this form here. So you notice here you've got I's and J's for your electrons, but you've got eta 1 and eta 2 for the positions of your two holes. So these then are the eta 1 and eta 2 label the positions of the holes. And incidentally, that state is more complicated than the states you usually run across in the quantum Hall effect. Can't be expressed in this simple form. Now, here comes the crunch, and this is the bit which really gets complicated. Let's consider a 4 quasi-hole state, that is, two quasi-hole pairs. And let's just start. This looks sort of trivial, but let me go through this argument. Let's actually start with only 2 electrons in your problem. How do you actually make 4 quasi-holes when you've only got 2 electrons? Well, they do it in this, this wave function here. So you've now got eta 1, eta 2, eta 3, eta 4. Let's abbreviate that as 1, 2, and 3, 4. You see, eta1 and eta2 appeared in the sense that the product is z1 here and z1 here, z2 here and z2 here. You say, okay, you've got these states, but at first sight there are two other possibilities. You could pair them so that, for example, you had z1 minus eta1, z1 minus eta3, z2 minus eta2, etc. That would be, in this language, that would be a pairing 1, 3 and 2, 4. Similarly, this third one here. However, now there's a bit of algebra, which is, again, seems sort of trivial, but it is, it may actually be quite important. If you just do a straightforward bit of algebra, you find that the difference between these two is an expression which factors in this rather simple way. And again, a little more algebra, you find that this gives rise to a linear relationship between these three states, which does not depend on the z's. That's the important point. It depends on the etas, depends on the positions of the holes. It does not depend on the positions of the electrons. In other words, there are only two linearly independent functions. Now, for the case of n equals 2, you can actually do the algebra more or less by hand. Anything more than that gets really pretty complicated, and Nyack and Wilczek have to go to quite some lengths to justify this. But they do, in fact, have an argument to justify that this result still holds when n is greater than 2, and more importantly, can be generalized to the case of 2n quasi-holes. In fact, what they find is that for 2n quasi-holes, there are exactly 2 to the n minus 1 independent states. Now, you might have thought at first sight that if you had 2n quasi-holes, then each of them, as it were, could be present or absent. So that will give you a 2 to the 2n independent states. But in fact, because of these linear relationships, that's no longer true. Now, this might ring a bell here. You might remember that it was exactly this factor which we got when we were talking about vortices in a P plus IP Fermi superfluid. So this strongly suggests that what we're seeing here is an implementation of the idea of Ising anions. And indeed, it does turn out to be so. Nyack and Wilczek go on to exhibit an explicit form of a possible choice of basis states. You see, and now you see you're only involving two of these three combinations because as we've said, the third one is not linearly independent of these. So that's for four quasi holes, you have only two linearly independent states, and this is one way of choosing them, where X is this so-called cross cross structure factor, word to that effect. This is, incidentally, this is a well-known beast in the theory of, in general theory of complex variables in mathematics. Anyone remember what its name is? No? Okay. It does have a name, but I've forgotten it. Okay. Again, this is perhaps the trickiest bit of all in this whole game. Imagine that you actually take that cross ratio, small compared to 1. Crudely speaking, what that means is you put 1 close to 2 and 3, quasi-hole number 1 close to number 2 and 3 close to number 4. And then your wave function gets simplified. It has this form here. And again, there has to be something wrong. Yeah, there must be a minus sign. Yeah, I'm sorry, there's almost certainly a minus sign in this one here. Otherwise, this is just the same expression, so which can't be right. Yes, I'm sure that is right, actually. It should be a minus sign. Then it's fairly clear that if you simply interchange 1 and 2, or 3 and 4, you get only a phase factor. But if you interchange, for example, 2 and 3, that gives you a non-trivial rotation in this space. Again, just as in the case of vortices in a P plus IP superfluid. Now, it's not obvious what these phase change, effects of rotation ought to be. It turns out that on this replacement, the phase acquired is actually pi over 2. That's perhaps not what you might expect if you remember that the charge on your quasar hole is e over 4. You might perhaps expect pi over 4, but it actually comes out to be pi over 2. And that, again, is exactly the same as it was for the P plus IP case. And in fact, this property that in a particular basis, as it were, the diagonal exchange of two of your anions gives you a phi factor of pi over 2. That's, in some sense, a defining property of the class of Ising anions systems. So these states can, in principle, then be used for a qubit. And more generally, again, as in the P plus IP case, 2n anions do give you n qubits. Now, say the algebra necessary to derive these results is extremely complicated, in fact. And the moment you get to more than two electrons, it becomes almost impossible. However, these results, which you might have guessed intuitively, are confirmed by numerical calculations. These are probably not the most recent ones, but these are certainly some fairly definitive numerical calculations for that one. So it does look then, I mean, everything is consistent with the idea that these quasar holes in a new equals, in the Moore-Reed state, if it exists, are behaving like Ising anions. And that, of course, is why people are excited from the point of view of topological quantum computing. So you look like you have a question. You could regard them effectively as Majorana fermions. That is, they have their braiding rules, their fusion rules, dot, 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 are exactly the same as those of Majorana fermions. Yes. I guess so, yes. Yes, that's right, yes. Yes, yes, that's a good way of putting it, I think.
There
yes.
Are only
mm.
two
yes. Yep.
Mm. States
yes. Yes.
Three
yes. Yes, I think that's a good way of putting it. One ought to be able, I mean, that of course is in some sense it's a challenge to extract that information from the explicit wave functions. I haven't seen that done, but I think it's an interesting, it would be interesting to try to do it. Okay, so that's basically is what I wanted to say about the theory. As you see, it gets really pretty complicated in places. And people spend, I mean, there are a whole sub-community of people who spend most of their time working on these precise wave functions and so forth. So it's by no means a trivial problem. Okay, so let's go on now to the experimental situation. First of all, proposals for experiments. Well, again, a whole lot of these in the literature. A particularly important paper, I think, not the only one, is by Stern and Halperin. But as I say, there are about a dozen papers probably along these general lines in the theoretical literature. The general idea goes something like this. Suppose that you've got some kind of current, which is flowing into or more precisely along the edges of your quantum Hall system. This is, in this diagram, the white parts here, the inner white parts are the quantum Hall system. The black parts are electrodes. You have a current which is input from outside into the edge of your quantum Hall system. It's flowing mostly like so and eventually back like so, but you've got these constrictions here, and occasionally an excitation is liable to tunnel across one of these two constrictions. Now, the general principle is that if you've got an even, again, this is not something I'll try to justify in detail, but this is a principle which has been used in essentially almost all the theoretical papers which propose interferometric experiments. Turns out, if you believe the standard Pfaffian wave function, etc., that for an even number of e over 4 quasar particles on your island, that's on this bit here, the bit between the two tunneling paths, the incoming quasar particles don't get entangled with the ones which are already there on the island. So your incoming quasar particles are going to be able to flow across these two constrictions in a coherent way, and therefore you would expect to see an Aurora-Boehm effect. So in other words, if you vary the if you vary the flux on the little dot that you've put in here, or if you change various other parameters, then you might expect to see an Aurora-Boehm effect. And in other words, there's going to be a term in the backscattered current, which is an interference term between transmission through T1 and T2. And it turns out that this varies with the field through the island in this way. So for an even number of trapped quasar particles, you do expect to see an interference effect in the backscattered current. For an odd number of quasar particles, the path through which this your quasar particle goes gets entangled with the state of the anions which are already there, and that's peculiar. That effect is peculiar to non-abelian anions. It would not happen with abelian ones. So that means that because you've now got entanglement, in some sense the quasar particles sitting in here are making a measurement of which path is followed here. So you destroy the interference between these two paths. So then you expect to see, either to see or not to see, an Aurora-Boehm oscillation in your current, depending on whether you've got an even or odd number of electrons, of quasar particles trapped here. So the theory behind that is not, as you see, not trivial, but this is something which is used in essentially all the theoretical proposals. Okay. So, experiments then. I guess the first experiments were done about 5 years ago on the five halves state. This is a Weizmann Institute experiment. It's a slightly complicated setup because you have two different filling factors and therefore two different fractional quantum Hall states here. These are the parameters. And what you measure is the shot noise associated with tunneling across this quantum point contact here. Now, I guess we've seen this expression before in the context of the Laughlin states. The theoretical prediction is this here, this rather complicated expression. The interesting thing about this expression is that in general, E star does appear in a number of different places. So that gives you quite a bit of control over. It's got a lot of knobs to turn, as it were. Just a couple of limits there. Delta G, incidentally, turns out to be, it's not obvious here, turns out to be the difference between what would be the quantum Hall conductances of your two different states here. So you have to know that, and there are ways of extracting that from other data with other fillings here. So you need to know these quantities. Again, nu equals 3 is a very standard integral quantum Hall effect, so you can get these out of that data. But the punchline is eventually they fit their noise as a function of the impinging current, which is basically the proportional to voltage in the standard way. And they fit it to two curves, one corresponding to E star equals E over 2, the other corresponding to E star equals E over 4. And you see from here, at least it's plausible that the effective charge which you're seeing is indeed E over 4 with a possible small or zero E over 2 contamination. However, one cannot, out of these data, get any particular conclusion about G. So far, so good. Next one, again, about 5 years old now. Standard gallium arsenide, aluminum gallium arsenide heterostructure. Again, sort of standard typical parameters here. Again, tunneling across a point contact. measuring essentially the longitudinal resistance and the Hall resistance at a fixed current, and from there, from the dependence on the the current that you can try to fit that to this expression here. Again, this not obvious where this comes from. This expression actually comes out from a calculation involving the explicit discussion of the edge state here. So in this expression, it turns out there are four fitting parameters here. They fit their, they try to fit their data to this expression. And what they find, interestingly, is that E star appears to be about 0.17, which you can argue is reasonably close to 0.25. G, however, is 0.35. Now, that is probably barely consistent with the 331 state, which is believed to have G equals 0.375. It's probably inconsistent with the Moore-Reed state. So, so it looks at this state, at least, as if the state is more likely to be 331 than Moore-Reed. Okay, but now the plot thickens. The a further set of experiments by the Lucent Technologies group. So again, good old gallium arsenide, aluminum gallium arsenide, heterostructures. Essentially, same typical values of the parameters. They measure the dependence of the longitudinal resistance on the magnetic field B and the gate voltage V. And as always in these in such experiments, you have to calibrate the effective area of the dot in here by well understood plateaus like 5/3 or 2. The effect of the gate voltage on this dot here is not primarily through charge accumulation. It's more through the change of the effective area of the dot and therefore the flux enclosed by it. And therefore, there should be a unique relationship between the period observed in V and that observed in VG, and indeed there is, it turns out. And if you plot either of these, you get this rather peculiar structure. But now, if you take the Fourier transform of that, you find, interestingly, at low temperature, the main component appears to correspond to E star's E over 4. However, there is an appreciable E over 2 component. Remember, that's different from Dolev et al., who saw essentially no E over 2 component. At higher temperatures, E over 2 dominates, in fact. Okay, well, that's bad enough, but now... worse is to follow. there's the same group. I have a more recent paper in which they confirm the occurrence of E over 4 and E over 2 periodicities, and they find the ratio patterns alternating as a function of the interferometer area. And their interpretation is that this is consistent with the prediction for non-abelian states, like Moore-Reed state, for an even number of quasar particles trapped in the interferometer, the period is E over 4, while for an odd number, that's suppressed, and the periodicity is E over 2. If that were true, it would be consistent with a non-abelian state such as Moore-Reed. Again, the theory which goes into here is, I would say, somewhat hand-waving, but at least the result is interesting. Second set of experiments. These guys measure, the quasi-particle tunnelling, like former experiments, measure the quasi-particle tunnelling as a function of temperature and of DC bias. They deduce the dimensionless parameters, E star and G, same way as Radu et al. Did. They find that that this ratio is somewhere around 0.25, as expected. G is somewhere in this region here. Now, you remember that for the 331 state, G was predicted to be 0.375, so that certainly fits. For the Moore-Reed state, G is 0.5, so that doesn't fit. So again, that seems to be pointing to 331. However, now this I think is in some sense a rather more, perhaps rather more convincing experiment, because the interpretation is considerably more direct in this case. This experiment was actually an electrically detected NMR experiment to infer the spin polarization of the new equals 5 half state. And they actually found quite unambiguously that this state was 100% spin polarized. Now you remember that is certainly true for the Moore-Reed state, or for that matter for the anti-Pfaffian state. It is certainly not true for the 331 state. So if this is right, I mean assuming this is right and there are no complications, then that seems pretty much a knockout for the 331 state. And one would have to conclude that it's either Moore-Reed or anti-Pfaffian, both of which would be interesting because both are non-abelian. The combination, if we assume that both of these results are correct, that raises, I think, the slightly unsettling question of whether, I mean, it's almost always in the history of the quantum Hall effect been assumed that, in some sense, if you know what the bulk states are, then you also know what the edge states are. There's, in fact, a very, very tight connection between the nature of the bulk and edge states. But if you believe both these experiments, then that looks as if it might not be the case, which is, I think, rather disturbing, actually. Okay, finally, some general remarks about the new equals 5 half state. Again, let's in some sense try to step back a little, and without considering detailed wave functions or anything of the kind, just try to think about what might follow from the actual filling factor alone in some sense. Well, once more, by the generic Wynn new argument, again I emphasise, not peculiar to quantum Hall state, not peculiar to odd denominators. We know that the ground state must be at least doubly degenerate. So now when we put, we actually take a realistic Corbino disk geometry and try to do the Hall effect in that, then by the original Laughlin argument, 2 phi 0 of flux must correspond to E in charge. So the minimum accessible periodicity of the free energy, and remember I went through this argument for the Laughlin state, and I'm just basically going through it again now. Minimum accessible periodicity of the free energy in phi is twice phi zero, corresponding to this double degeneracy on the torus. So in other words, you could have this picture here with a single electron making an adiabatic transition in this way. That's probably the wrong word. I actually mean a non-adiabatic transition, really. If it were really making an adiabatic transition, you'd get the integral quantum Hall effect. However, trivially, a half is 2 over 4. And therefore, an equally plausible scenario is that your free energy is actually periodic with period 4, but you have 2 electrons making the, again, non-adiabatic transition. And that then, intuitively at least, in a constricted Corbino disk geometry, which is basically the geometry of most of the experiments, this will give a noise corresponding to E over 4, a period of E over 4. So really that raises the question, can you infer anything from the fact that the apparent observed charge on your quasar particles is E over 4? And basically it seems that all you can really infer is that you have some kind of pairing there. And incidentally, you remember that just about all the states we considered, all the states in the zoo, did in fact give you E star equals E over 4. None of them give you E over 2. So that seems at least consistent. So to get more out of that, you do have to get more than that, and to make a more, if you like, a more precise discrimination between the different possible states, you really need to measure things like the shot noise or the edge tunneling spectroscopy of the edges and so forth. That in turn requires you to have a decent theory of the edge states. And, as I say, normally one assumes that if you have a particular wave function for the bulk, that'll give you your, the correct each state. But some of the experiments seem to be suggesting otherwise in this case. So, in other words, the executive summary of this lecture is that the whole thing is a complete mess. There are rather few statements we can make with any reasonable degree of confidence about the nu equals 5 halves state. I mean, theorists would certainly really very much like to have it be the Moore-Reed state, I think. And if it were, then of course we could in principle do topological quantum computation with it, which means that you can publish dozens of papers in the literature on proposals to do topological quantum computation with it. However, right now at least, nature seems to be a lot more complicated than that. And we're still really lacking a complete smoking gun experiment as to what this beast actually is. Okay, I've got, that basically exhausts what I wanted to say, or what I have slides for rather, here. We have 10 minutes left. Should we just have a general discussion, or should I just go on and say something very briefly about the Kitaev honeycomb model? Any thoughts? Okay, well, why don't I just at least say a few words about the Kitaev honeycomb model. I'm not sure if I'll have time to get back to this in any more detail later in the last few lectures. I suspect probably not, so maybe a good time to say something about it. So, like the toric code, the Kitaev honeycomb model is a sort of specially engineered theoretical system which hopefully is going to be exactly soluble. We'll see at least some sense it is exactly soluble. Like so many other good things in this area, as the name implies, it was invented by Kitaev, and I guess the publication, although he invented it some years ago, the publication is actually a long Annals of Physics paper in 2006. As the name implies, what you consider is a honeycomb lattice in two dimensions. So it's essentially graphene, at least the structure is that of graphene. Incidentally, just a question to anyone who might know, the decorative structure on this side of the building is a slightly distorted honeycomb model. Does anyone know what particularly that was meant to refer to? Is it graphene, or is it Kitaev, or what? Anyway, okay.
I think it's on the nano side.
So sorry?
It's on the nano side, so I'm guessing it has to represent graphene.
Ah, yes, I guess so. Yes, probably so. Yes, anyway. So you have a nice honeycomb model. And now what is special about this is that, and I think probably I need three different colours of pencil here. Green. Okay. Let's see if we can do it with this. Okay. So we, I'm going to draw the sides of my honeycomb cells in different colours. Seeing all these pencils are going to work. Green. Green. Okay, so we have another green down here, another blue up here, etc., etc. Now, you see that you associate spins with the actual vertices of this model, not with the links. You remember, in the case of the toric code, the spins are associated with the links, but in this case, they're associated with the actual vertices. So you think of these as lattice points, if you like. And now if you consider any particular spin sitting here, it has three neighbours in different directions. And so the form of Hamiltonian, which Kitaev wrote down, is that the you have a term j, let's say j, sigma x, sigma sigma x1, sigma x2 for any two spins which are connected by a red line. Then you have also plus, that's jx, plus jy times sigma, I'm probably going to do this in a different colour actually, shouldn't I? Let me think, so let's have this one to be blue, and jy be sigma y1, sigma y2 for any two spins which are connected with a blue line. And finally, you have a jz, sigma z1, sigma z2 for any two spins which are connected by a green line. So that doesn't look, at first sight, a particularly fancy Hamiltonian. In fact, one might even think that one had a relatively good chance of somehow simulating it. And indeed, it turns out one does. But it does have some rather amusing properties. It turns out. Again, I just sort of tell you this without any attempt at derivation. It turns out that if the J's do not satisfy the so-called triangle inequality, that is, if the if one of them is bigger than the difference between the other two, then in fact the problem becomes relatively trivial. It turns out that you have a nice ground state, you have abelian anions, etc., etc. So that's not particularly interesting. In the case where the triangle inequality is satisfied, so crudely speaking, jx, jy, and jz are all of the same order of magnitude, then life gets a lot more interesting. It turns out that your excitations now do appear to behave as non-abelian anions, in fact as Ising anions. Now, as it stands, the model has the unfortunate property of not actually having a gap. However, it turns out that if you apply a field in the right direction, and it has to be actually in along a sort of one-on-one axis, then in fact you can create a gap which is proportional to the cube of the field. So you've now got, and you this doesn't spoil the structure of your excitations and so forth. So you've now got yourself a system which does indeed have a ground state separated from any of its excited states by a non-zero gap. And moreover, the excitations do appear to behave as non-abelian anions, and in fact precisely as Ising anions. The way that result has usually been obtained in the literature is by mapping the system onto the standard P plus IP Fermi superfluid description. There are more direct ways of doing it, in particular if you're prepared to do a fair amount of heavy computation, you can get away without having to do that. And in fact, there's a recent paper by, Hilary referred me to it, which goes into rather heavy numerical computation and does indeed demonstrate, I think satisfactorily, that first of all, the statistics of your excitations are those of Ising anions. Moreover, for the pure system, that is for the simple Hamiltonian at least, the corrections to the, as it were, asymptotic results do fall off exponentially with the distance in the, as they're supposed to, so forth. But as I say, in literature, mostly these results have been obtained by making a mapping to an effective P plus IP Fermi superfluid model. Now, I am going to be later expressing scepticism about some of the results obtained for the P plus IP Fermi superfluid. But I should say, in this context, that all that is required is that this maps onto, as it were, the standard, the usually accepted description of a Fermi superfluid. So it doesn't matter whether that description is actually the description of real strontium ruthenate or whatever. Okay. So I think that even if my scepticism about these results for strontium ruthenate, etc., are justified, it doesn't affect the validity of this particular mapping. Yeah. So as I say, this is a nice theoretical model. Can we implement it experimentally? Well, there have been various proposals. I think probably the most plausible proposal as of now uses ultra-cold atoms in optical lattices. It's amazing. It turns out that if you have enough lasers and enough manpower, etc., etc., you can basically simulate just about any Hamiltonian using a suitable ultra-cold optical lattice setup. And so there was a proposal by Duan Serra-Gonzola a few years ago to construct the Gitaev honeycomb model. You might ask, why hasn't it been done? I think the answer to that is rather simple and straightforward. To do anything useful involving internal degrees of freedom, like spin or hyperfine state, in an atomic lattice, you've got to be able to get down to temperatures which are low enough compared to the characteristic interaction scale. Now, unfortunately, in real life, ultra-cold atomic lattices, that scale is something like 10 to the minus 12 K. don't laugh too hard, because in fact, people are getting down to something like 10 to the minus 11 right now. So it's by no means unthinkable that's going to be done in the next few years, I think. A second kind of proposal, which has been made, involves superconducting qubits. It turns out that if you make yourself a sufficiently complicated array of superconducting qubits coupled together in an appropriate way, then you can actually, in principle, replicate the Gitaev honeycomb model. Why isn't that being done? I suspect the answer there is just such a pain, actually. You have to actually engineer an array. I mean, for this to make any real sense, you've got to be able to, I don't know, have an array of at least a few dozen sites, I would think. So you've got to get all your couplings exactly right, etc., etc. Nevertheless, again, it's I think with adequate motivation, people should be able to do that. I guess a lot of things in this area, I'm sure you're all very well aware, a lot of things in the whole area of quantum computation generally depend on having adequate motivation. It may be technically possible, but it may be such a pain that you don't want to do it unless there's a good reason to. Okay, I think I'd better stop there, in fact.